Good afternoon, everybody. He has risen. Amen. Amen. He has risen indeed, and thank you for that response. I was listening. I think God allowed me, Holy Spirit allowed me to be in the car to hear someone who was actually speaking. Who was actually speaking from the very text that I'd be speaking from today. And I said, "Ooh, Lord, look at you." Well, okay. And one of the things that he said that I hadn't thought about is, if it's okay, Zoe, if Facebook was around and the news was around at the time that Jesus was risen from the grave, had risen from the grave, it would have been over everything. You talk about hits, he would have had hashtags and hits, and we would have had all kinds of connections, and we would have spread that news so quickly. You could just imagine, it would be the biggest thing to happen. This is a day that when I woke up this morning, I hope you were as excited as I was. And the reason I was excited, because, I mean, I just wanted to get to church. This is a big deal. This is a big day. This is an important day. Around the world, millions of Christians have gathered. You know, and thank God we can gather in safety here. But millions are gathering despite what they could be facing by gathering today. You know, just praying that no bomb threat has come someplace, and that people are being, they are being persecuted, but praying for that protection today as we celebrate. Because if we did not have this day, if Christ never rose from the dead, there's no sense in us being here. There would really be no Christianity without this resurrection. That's why it's so important to be here. And no, it's not about the eggs, and no, it's not about the bunnies. It's about the risen Lord. And we celebrate that, and we're excited about that. And I hope you're as excited as I am. Let's walk through the week. Sunday, Hosanna, praise Him, glory to God in the highest. Everybody was excited to see Him because they thought that change was going to come with Him right there. They thought He was going to change the government and stuff like that right there. So He went through the week. And as He went through the week, He was healing people. As He went through the week, He was preaching. And then came Thursday night. The night that He knew, He already knew what was going to happen. He knew why He was placed here. He and His Father are one. He knew what was going to happen. And we talked about this Thursday night. What did He do? He gathered with His friends during one of the darkest times of His life. You know, he was human. So of course He was not like, "Oh, yay, tomorrow I'm going to be crucified." It was agonizing to think about it. But He gathered with His friends. And He prayed to His Father, which we talked about on Thursday, be an example for us of what we should do when we're in the darkest times. Gather with your friends. Don't pull away. Gather with your God. And then He was arrested that night, put on trial, beaten, Friday, crucified, so ugly. Something we can't even imagine, and quite frankly, something we don't want to imagine. But done for us. And don't think of us as a whole. You could say, done for me. Because He would have done it if there was just you. That's sobering. That's how much He loves you. That's how much He loves you. Crucifixion, sun went down. Sabbath day came. You didn't hear anything about that. It was quiet then. They don't even have anything in the... It was Saturday. It was the Sabbath. They went to temple, church. But can you imagine what they would be feeling all that day? Yesterday, my Lord was killed. I don't know what's going on, because they didn't know what was going on. They had no idea really what was going to happen Sunday morning. They were walking around in confusion. It was very dark for them, even though they were celebrating on the Sabbath day. It was very confusing, and they were afraid because they didn't know what it all meant. We know what it all means because we got the beginning of the story and we're heading to the very end, but we already know the ending. They didn't know. They know what they were told, but they had no idea what it would look like. We do. The blessing of hindsight and vision and reading. Then Sunday morning, he's not there. He's risen from the grave. He is not there. I love it. We're going to look at today in Matthew 28, verses 1 through 7. And I might go a little further than that, but Pat, just bear with me. Don't worry. Matthew, I hope we have it. Matthew 28, verses 1 through 7. We know that we can read of all the accounts in the four Gospels, which are Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. So I recommended on Thursday, if you had not read all those accounts, you'll want to go back and read those, because each one of them gives a different viewpoint and more details. Less details, more details, by reading the account of when Jesus was crucified and his resurrection. But let's start in Matthew 28, verse 1, as we read. After the Sabbath at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. Now, they're talking about two Marys, but there were actually four women who went that day. But these are the only ones referred to in Matthew. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary. How would you like, ladies, to be referred to as the other Mary? She was the other Mary, you know. Not the one, not Mary Magdalene, but the other one. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. Verse 4, the guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. Talk about being scared to death. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are here looking for Jesus who was crucified." Verse 6, "He is not here. He has risen." Get this part, because usually we stop at "He has risen." "Just as he said." Just as he said. "Come and see the place where he lay." And verse 7, "Then go quickly and tell his disciples he is risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you." We're going to stay right here because this is good. This is what he said to them then, but everything said to them back then applies to us now. Applies to us now. As I was talking about those men, when they saw that angel, they were scared to death. Because you know what? When you know that you're doing wrong, when you know you're doing wrong, you're scared. You're scared. Because you don't know what's around the corner for me. I know I shouldn't be doing this. I'm watching the grave of a man who did nothing wrong. But as a Roman soldier, I've got my job to do. Then this angel comes, and I love it. The angel didn't even speak to them. It's like the angel said, "Yeah, you better be scared." But to the women, he said, "Don't be afraid." Pastor David always says that when you have an encounter with an angel and they say, "Don't be afraid," if they say, "Don't be afraid," it could either be the best day of your life or the worst day of your life. For these women, it was starting to be the best day of their life. The best day of their life. "Don't be afraid," the angel said to them. "I know you're looking for Jesus. I know you're looking for Jesus." These women went to that gravesite with no idea what they were going to find. They were worried about the stone being rolled back. They said, "Who's going to roll back the stone for us so we can finish anointing his body. They brought spices. They weren't expecting a risen Lord. Notice that it was the four women that went. The disciples were nowhere to be seen. They were not expecting him to rise up either. It was unexpected. They had no idea. If you think about that, these women and the disciples, everyone who saw him crucified, going through that Saturday. And then the angel said, I know who you're looking for. I know why you're here. I know why you're here. For us today, here's what it reminds me of. First, the do not be afraid. Whenever you go seeking Jesus, as these women were doing, don't be afraid of what happens in your life. When you go seeking after God, you will find him. Don't fear. I've talked about before how many times it says some form of fear not, do not fear in the Bible. I was told 365 times. I keep getting a better number. How many days in the year? 365. One to cover each day. Why? Because you will be scared. There are times in your life when you will fear. They said, do not fear. I'm looking at Psalms 56, verse 3, by way of reminder. When I am afraid, I put my trust in you, because I'm going to be fearful. When I'm afraid, I'll put my trust in you. And then Psalms 94, verse 19. When anxiety was great within me, your consolation brought me joy. Today, what that means to us is Jesus saying, don't worry, I've got you. Don't worry, I've got you. And I think that some of us need to hear that today. Whatever worry or whatever concern or whatever fear that you may be experiencing, don't worry. He's got you. He's risen. Verse 6, when it said, he is not here, he has risen, just as he said. He has risen. Just for those women, what shocking news. What joyful news. They're still a little confused. You know, you're still in shock. He's risen just as he said. They knew he'd spoken something about it. Still, we're showing up to take care of the rest because we don't know if it's actually going to happen today. But Jesus had risen just as he promised. And because he kept that promise, you can be confident that he will keep every promise he has made. May you never doubt that. This was the big one. This was the big one. He'll keep the promises he's made and keep them in our lives. And I love that because of his resurrection, it proves that he's not an imposter. He's not a false prophet. And there was no trick involved. You know, I've watched that magician, Chris Angel. He flew off of a roof and comes down to the crowd. And they're wondering how he did it, because you can't see any jet propeller, nothing. He flies off, and I thought to myself, if he dressed up and tried to look like Jesus, people would believe that. People would actually believe if they don't know all that goes with it. Because somebody's coming who's going to show signs like that. And if you're not careful, the very elect will be confused. Don't be fooled by a magician's trick. And we're not. And we're not. What I love is that, and this is the part I heard on the way here. He talked about all of these famous men, these attorneys, who were determined to prove that Jesus did not rise from the grave. They spent more time than you and I would ever spend. They are more learned and studied than any of us would ever be. They studied and studied. And do you know what conclusion they came to? Is that it happened. These men did not believe in God, but when they finished trying to disprove that he had risen from the grave, and they proved that he had, because the evidence was overwhelming, they gave their lives to Christ. Can you believe that? That's how strong the evidence is. Now let's think about the evidence we read in the Bible as we look at how this happened. First of all, the day of the crucifixion, the Roman soldier told Pilate that Jesus was dead. He's dead. Now I feel that they've done a lot of crucifixions and they know a dead body when they see it. He's dead. Because you had to report back. The other is, they did not break his legs because that was the normal thing to do to stop them from breathing so that they would hang there and have trouble with their lungs and inhaling. He was already dead. They didn't have to break his legs. So what did they do? Pierced him in the side where blood and water came out. The two Marys were there when he was placed in the tomb. The two Marys had come and they had watched his body be placed in the tomb. And Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus wrapped Jesus' dead body. They anointed it as much as they could with the time that they had. Mary saw him placed in there. Now then, a large stone was placed in front of the entryway with guards to guard it so that no one would come and steal the body. The stone was put there so that no one could get in and no one could get out. And no, there was no back way in or out. So this is what the Romans did to make sure that no one thought that he would rise. But you know what they did later? Is they told those two guards, after the guards went back and said, man, you won't believe what we saw. This thing, bright, came, scared us stiff, and Jesus isn't in there anymore. The leader said, don't tell anybody that. Here's some money. Here's the story you tell. You say that the disciples came and took him away. And that's going to be the end of your story. They took that money and people believe that story to this day. That the disciples came and took his body away. Why would they do that and not make it reappear later? Why? Everything hung on this. Everything hung on this. But even if that part didn't happen, those parts in the Bible, we can go back to the Old Testament. And several things that happened in that week and during his crucifixion were prophesied from the Old Testament. And I'm going to go through these very quickly. And if you want a copy of it, I'll bring some more copies next week because it has the prophecy and then it has when it was fulfilled. It has when it was prophesied in the Old Testament. So even if you didn't go to the New Testament, it talked about what was going to happen in the New Testament and then it was fulfilled. I'm going to start where it says, Messiah was to enter Jerusalem in triumph. That was prophesied in Zechariah 9:9. Messiah was to be rejected by his own people. Isaiah 53 verses 1 and 3. Messiah was to be betrayed by one of his followers. Psalm 41 verse 9. Before Jesus was born, I hope you're understanding that. He was to be tried and condemned. Isaiah 53 verse 8. Messiah was to be silent before his accusers. He knew what he was going to. Isaiah 53 verse 7. Messiah was to be struck and spat on by his enemies. Isaiah 50 verse 6. Messiah was to be mocked and insulted. Psalm 22 verses 7 and verse 8. Messiah was to die by crucifixion. Psalms 22 verse 14, 16, 17. Messiah was to suffer with criminals and pray for his enemies. Isaiah 53 verse 12. He was to be given vinegar and gall. Psalm 69 verse 21. Others were to cast lots for the Messiah's garments. Psalm 22 verse 18. Messiah's bones were not to be broken. Exodus 12 46. Messiah was to die as a sacrifice for sin. Isaiah 53 verses 5, 6, 8, 10, 11, 12. Messiah was to be raised from the dead. Psalm 16 verse 10. from the old to the new. You can stand on faith too, even if you didn't know that. But because you know that, you can hush the naysayers. You can hush the naysayers. There is evidence after evidence that he rose. That he rose, that it really happened. He said in Psalm 16, verse 10, I think you may have this, you may not. We do. Because you will not abandon me in the realm of the dead, nor will you let your faithful one see decay. He was talking about Jesus there, not David. That was talking about Jesus. Will not see decay. If he had not risen, nothing would be true for us today. But because he rose, it's all true for us today. If he had not risen, this is what we base all of our Christianity on, the risen Christ. We can be certain of our resurrection because of his resurrection. Because he rose, you can be certain you will rise too. He and his Father are one. He lives in us, which makes us one with him. When he rose up, we rose up. Death is not the end. Death is not the end. We have no reason to fear it when the time comes. It's not the end for us. Jesus was more than just a human leader. He was the Son, is the Son of God. Is the Son of God. Man, I get excited about that. The next thing the angel said was, come and see. Come and see to the ladies. He wanted the women not to take his word for it. He said, come on inside. Come take a look yourself. What a gift they were given to be able to get a testimony about he wasn't in there. He wasn't there. All they saw was the folded linen in the shape of the body, the head part folded. Nobody, nobody was there. For us today, what does come and see mean? Come and see means same thing. Come and prove this for yourself. He is risen. Come inside and take a look. Come be part of this. Come and see who Jesus is. Come and see and get your own testimony. It's nice to hear how Jesus has moved in someone else's life, but when you can talk about the healing he gave you, the way he poured you through that particular storm, when you can talk about it in your own life, I'm telling you, it becomes more real for you, obviously. Stop living on someone else's testimony. We all have our own, or you wouldn't be sitting here today. You would not be sitting here today. So come and see, be a witness. We're now part of that ongoing work done in the name of Jesus. He's saying, come be part of it. Come be part of it. Come and take up your cross. Come and see this Savior who now sits through the Holy Spirit, lives in us, and sits on the right hand of his Father, our Lord and Savior, who we recognize the sacrifice was made on behalf of our sins. This Lamb of God, come and see and get it. Get it. Then the angel said, go and tell. Go and tell. After you come and see, go and tell. The women were to go and tell what they had witnessed. He has risen. And they had to go find the disciples. You know, they didn't stop to talk to anybody else because their direction was to go and tell the disciples. Our direction is go and tell in all the world who he is. And that he has risen. We have an assignment, just like those ladies had that assignment. Go and tell. Not only that he is risen. And I don't know if any of you have not accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior. I don't know. Maybe some need to be baptized. I think we all are. I'm not sure. I don't know. But it's when you start seeking Christ like that, you begin to see that movement in your life in a powerful way that you want to go and tell. That you want to go and tell. Go into all the world, baptizing them in the name, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Letting them know Jesus is risen. And he has all authority under his feet because his Father passed it down to him. Now the angel says this, and I didn't catch it until I was studying it. Right at the end, the angel says, "Now I have told you." That's like, I have done my part. You have been told. What you do with it from here is up to you. I have delivered the message. What a truth for us. When you deliver the message, that's your job, mission. I'm not going to say mission accomplished because there'll be more missions to deliver, more messages to deliver. But he said, "Now I have told you, we have accepted that Jesus died for our sins and that he's our Lord and Savior. We've been given our instructions. So my question to you is, now what will you do?" Remembering that for Christ, the week started with praise of Jesus as he entered the city and he heard Hosanna. Then Thursday. Then Friday. Then Saturday. And then Sunday. I'm going back to Saturday. Some of us may be stuck in Saturday right now in our lives. Confused. Afraid. But remember, Sunday is coming. You will not stay there. We don't stay on Saturday because there is a Sunday. There is the day he rose, and the confusion gave way to joy. The fear gave way to joy. It all gave way to a testimony. So if you're in Saturday right now, don't be afraid. Don't fear, because Sunday's coming. Someone said, "Don't doubt in the dark what you know to be true in the light." And I think about Pastor David at this time. Right now, it's just pretty dark what's going on over there. And what I mean by that is it's discouraging. He needs our prayers. But I also know that what I know about Pastor David is he knows the truth even when he's in the dark. We know the truth, but we have to be reminded every now and then. What I know to be true still holds true when I'm walking through a storm. The truth does not change. The truth does not change. You think about those who walked with Jesus. They walked with him for 3 years in that earthly ministry. And yet they were hiding. They were scared. Imagine us. We didn't get to walk with him. Ours is based on faith and what we read and the Holy Spirit. Of course there are going to be times of fear. Just like there were for them, even denied him. Once again, showing you're not going to be perfect. You're not going to be 100%. You're not. But don't let that stop you from seeking him, from telling about him. Don't let it stop you. We don't celebrate a dead body in a grave. We celebrate a risen Christ. It said in a prophecy in Psalm 110, verse 1, I think we have it. "The Lord says to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet." He's at his Father's right hand right now. It says in Luke 24, verses 50 through 51. "When he had led them out to the vicinity of Bethany, he lifted up his hands and blessed them. While he was blessing them, he left them and was taken up to heaven. That's the last place he was. He is. He's there. And I loved Mark, and this one's not on the screen. Mark 16, verses 19 through 20. It said, after the Lord Jesus had spoken to them, he was taken to heaven and set at the right hand of his Father. And then the disciples went out and preached everywhere. And the Lord worked with them and confirmed his word by the signs that he accompanied it. Last words to his disciples. Go into all the world, preaching. I've risen. I'm not here any longer. And what did the angel say? Now I have told you. Now I have told you. So let's go and spread the word. Amen? Let's pray. Father in heaven, Lord God, we come before you, Lord. We just give you glory and praise because you are God. We thank you, Lord, for the risen resurrection of your Son. Lord, that sacrifice that was made for us all those many years ago holds true for us today. Lord, we are grateful. We're grateful that we can come and see. We are grateful that we can go and tell. And we're grateful that you are a Lord who keeps your promise, the only true God. We walk away from here filled with joy for our risen Christ. We're going to spread the word, and we thank you. We thank you. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.